I'm Michael Weber, Artistic Director of Chicago's Porchlight Music Theater. Opening on Broadway at the Majestic Theater, November 4th, 1954, Fanny, with a book by N.S. Berman and Joshua Logan and music and lyrics by Harold Rome, was based on the play and film trilogy Marius, Fanny, and Cesar by Marcel Pagnol. Directed by co-author Joshua Logan, the original cast included Florence Henderson as Fanny, Ezio Pinza as Cesar, William Tabert as Marius, and Walter Slezak as Panisse. The play is the story of Fanny, a young woman whose childhood love, Marius, leaves her to go to sea as a sailor for 5 years. His father, Cesar, a tavern owner, disowns him. After his departure, Fanny discovers she's pregnant. Under pressure from her mother, she marries Panisse, an older man whose delight at having an heir prompts him to keep the boy's illegitimacy a secret. When Marius returns on his son's first birthday to claim both him and Fanny, the story moves towards its dramatic conclusion. Joshua Logan directed a 1961 film adaptation of Fanny based on both Pagnol's original plays and the book he and N.S. Berman had written for the stage musical. Although all the songs were eliminated, Harold Rome's music was heard in the soundtrack underscore. The film starred Leslie Caron, Marie Chevalier, Charles Boyer, and Horst Buchholz. 4 days after Fanny premiered on Broadway, the company and some guests assembled with Skitch Henderson and his orchestra to discuss the newly opened production and to meet the cast and to present musical selections to whet the appetites of audience members who would have the glorious gift of experiencing Fanny live on stage at the Majestic Theater. Here on the November 8, 1954 episode of NBC's Best of All, our composer-lyricist Harold Rome, singers Elizabeth Doubleday, Clark Dennis, Earl Wrightson, and the show's stars, Ezio Pinza, William Tabert, and Florence Henderson as Fanny.
This is Best of All. Tonight, starring Skitch Henderson with Earl Wrightson, Clark Dennis, Elizabeth Doubleday, Sylvia Michaels, and Keith Texter, and interviews with Ezio Pinza, Florence Henderson, William Tabert, and composer Harold Rome. This is Kenneth Banghart presenting for NBC Best of All, another in a series of programs saluting each week an outstanding American achievement in the fields of musical comedy, operetta, and motion pictures. This week, Best of All, partly transcribed, salutes the opening of a great new musical show on Broadway, Fanny. We'll hear all about Fanny in a moment, but first a song from this production. Clark Dennis sings and Skitch Henderson and the orchestra play Restless Heart.
I see a silver bird that streaks the sky. And off we fly, my heart and I. My restless heart and I see a cloud dance by and fade from view. There we go to my heart and I. My restless heart and I say to each new ship that sails the bay, are you the one it will be? Have you come at last this golden day to set us free? Take us away with you, we cry, my restless heart. My restless, 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 restless heart and I. Ship that sails the bay, are you the one it will be? Have you come at last this golden day to set us free? Take us away. My restless, 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 my restless heart.
Last Thursday night, Broadway welcomed a new and wistfully engaging musical. How this enterprise came about is more than usually interesting. Those who frequent the art theaters and the movie houses which offer foreign films have long been aware of a series of three tender, charmingly funny, and heart-winning motion pictures from France, entitled respectively Marius, Fanny, and César. These three connected stories were from the pen of that delightful teller of humorous tales, Marcel Pagnol. And they form the basis of the new musical, Fanny. Abetting one another in a conspiracy to make us forget all grave and serious matters are David Merrick and Joshua Logan, the producers, S.N. Behrman and Joshua Logan, the authors of the musical drama, Joshua Logan, the director, Harold Rome, the composer, and in addition to many other fine performers, Ezio Pinza, Walter Slezak, William Tabbert, and a delightful newcomer, Florence Henderson, whom you'll hear later in this program. At this point, I'm going to ask Skitch Henderson to introduce one of the principal collaborators in the great musical family. Skitch?
Thank you, Mr. Banghart. This night is a special thrill for me. It's always a thrill to do music of the American theater, but especially when a musical that we're dealing with tonight, this musical being Fanny, has to do with friends of mine in the American theater, it probably makes emotionally a great deal of difference. Tonight, as Ken has told you, we are doing not only music of Fanny, but we are doing music of and about the life of one Mr. Harold Rome, who put most of the effort into this great score, which we're going to do for you tonight. And I thought by way of formal billing, Harold, if I may, first I should say good evening.
Good evening. Good evening, Skitch.
Now we'll put away the formality. Harold, I'd like to go back into your life just a little bit, not too many years, of course, but I'd like to remind the people that you have given us many other great hours of pleasure in the theater. Where would we begin?
Well, if I've been around for a long time, go back to 1937, which was Pins and Needles, my first show.
Mm-hmm. Which was a hit.
Yes, it ran for 4 years. It spoiled me a little bit, you know, because mm-hmm. I said, how long has this been going on? You write a show and bang, it goes for 4 years. It didn't happen again.
How did you happen to be called in on Pins and Needles?
Well, I was a rehearsal pianist for it. You know, earned my way through college playing the piano.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd gotten a job in a summer theater writing shows.
Mm-hmm.
And this was the International Ladies' Garment Workers Union.
I remember
They were
that.
Planning to do an amateur review, and they called me in as rehearsal pianist. I played three nights a week for them. I made $25 a week for it, and I threw in my material free. And finally, after a year of rehearsal, the show was put on, supposedly for weekends. We played one weekend, and it became such a smash that all the members had to join Actors Equity, and it went on to run for 4 years.
What was some of the music that you did for the score of Pins and Needles?
Well, the one that you might remember is Sunday in the Park. That's the first song I ever had on the hit parade.
Mm-hmm.
And boy, I'll never forget that either. Driving in the car, which I had been able to buy from the royalties of Pins and Needles, turning on the radio and hearing the hit parade and hearing my own song on it.
How about, I think we should mention also Call Me Mister.
Oh, yes, that was after a term in the Army. I was in the Army from 1943 for about 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
And after I got out, I did Call Me Mister, which was a show about the fun of getting out of the Army and the trials and tribulations of being in the Army. I entered the Army as a private and came out as a corporal. In 3 years, I worked myself up.
Mm-hmm.
But I think on account of that, I could write the show, which was from the enlisted man's point of view.
I remember South America. Take it away from that.
Yeah, that was in that show. Call Me Mister was in that mm-hmm. show. Along with Me was from that, too. There are others. I keep playing the album every now and then. I love to go back mm-hmm. because it was a happy show.
How about Sing Out the News? What era did you do that?
Oh, Sing Out the News was 1939. That was my second show.
Just before the Army.
Well, I had a wonderful song out of that called Franklin D. Roosevelt Jones, which did very well, too.
That's the song that I always think of. It's funny, you know, I associate that song with you more than any other song. I think that everybody that's in the music profession associates certain songs with certain writers. Whenever I think of you, I always think of that song.
Well, you couldn't please me more by saying that.
I suppose that the number one talk as a predecessor to Fanny should be Wish You Were Here, which is really quite a fabulous story as far as Broadway is concerned.
Yeah, well, that's the last show.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, that is a fabulous story. That's the story where we got, shall we say, lukewarm reviews on the whole, except for dear old John Chapman, who loved it from the first day. And we kept working on the show for 2 months, 3 months afterwards. And it turned into a big smash hit, finally.
Harold, how do you attribute a show like that being a success? Is it word of mouth in spite of the critics?
There's one thing that makes the show a success after the critics, if it can survive the critics long enough, and that is whether the audience likes it.
Mm-hmm.
The big test of a show, we found out, anyone can find out in a theater, is the audience. If they love it, if they go out and tell their friends to go, that's what makes the show, and that's what makes a hit in the final analysis. The reviews can help you at the beginning to get people to come to the theater and to keep you running until you can get enough word of mouth. But it's been proven time and time again that the only real test of a theater is the audience.
If you tuned in a bit late, ladies and gentlemen, may I repeat that you're listening to the voice of one Mr. Harold Rome, certainly a great man of popular music here in America. Harold, we're going to come back to you in just a little bit. I'm going to take a hiatus now talking to you and go back to the podium, if I may, and I'll turn this microphone over to Mr. Banghart.
The waltz, in the opinion of some of us, is never so lovely as when it's gay. And that's how it is in Fanny, where in the happiest moment of the show, everyone joins in the hit which Elizabeth Doubleday sings for us now. Why Be Afraid to Dance?
Why be afraid to dance, to dance? It's just
afraid.
wild again, running over, spilling wild again. That is all. Dancing, dancing makes the world a big surprise again, puts the devil in your eyes again.
Now perhaps Skitch Henderson can persuade Harold Rome to tell us something of the tribulations and triumphs involved in his preparing the music for Fanny. Skitch?
Thank you, Kenneth. Harold, I live my wife and I, Faye, live up in Connecticut, and we have a near neighbor by the name of Josh Logan, and quite a while ago he talked to us about his impending ideas about Fanny. Where did you enter the picture?
It was a year ago. I think over a year ago, January.
Mm-hmm.
That means not this last January, but
yes,
the January
year
before
ago.
That. When Josh was shown the pictures by David Merrick and decided to do the show, and they asked me to do the score. That's a long time, but this was a very tough job to do. Fanny is based on three plays by Marcel Pagnol, which were made into three movies. The total time of the three movies is 9 hours. And it's 9 hours packed full of the most wonderful stuff you've ever seen. And our problem was to, first, to condense it enough and be able to tell the story in 2.5 hours on the stage, which means about an hour and a quarter of book and an hour and a quarter of music. And it was a tough problem.
Harold, how in the world, in a story like this, which is an unusual story, really, for the theater, how do you go about deciding in which direction you're going to write? As far as
well, you talk
concerned.
It over. What really happens is you talk for a long time, trying to get the high emotional points of the story, because you know those are going to be the points where the songs come in. Josh Logan has a theory about songs in a musical, which is wonderful, which I've learned from him in the past 4 years of association, and which has been very valuable, which is that at a certain emotional point, when people can no longer talk, they sing. And if you can work that right, a song never feels forced. You never feel there's a cue to it. It just comes naturally out of the situation. So the first problem was to find those emotional points. And as a matter of fact, the first two songs I did were the two big emotional points. One was Welcome Home, and the other was Fanny. Those were the two first songs done. And although I wrote them, both of them, in about a day each, they were preceded by about 4 weeks of constant talk. If you examine Fanny, it may seem like a very simple song until you realize the problem we had there, which is a boy telling a girl that he loves the sea more than he loves her, and he's going to leave her and go to sea. But in doing that, he has to make the audience like him, show the audience why the girl likes him, show that he's a bit on the dreamy and poetic side, and make his leaving sound real. Now, this is a very tough job.
I'm very happy with what I'm doing at the present time. Harold, if you don't mind, I'll leave the theater to you. How much rewrite, how much editing does it take on the average song that you write?
Well, it depends. Sometimes they come right the first time, like Fanny, which was done in, as I say, one Sunday.
Yes, that
I started
surprised
in the
me
morning.
When you said that. Yes.
I started in the morning, and by the evening I had it, and not a note or not a lyric has been changed since then. But as I say, that was after talking it over for about 4 weeks. Now, Welcome Home, on the other hand, I did three versions of. The first was too long and too talky. Then I redid it again and didn't like the way the music went. So I finally did a third version. That, to get right, took about 4 months. Sometimes you get stale on a song. You have to just put it away and wait till you come back to it with a fresh point of view. Some Love is a Very Light Thing, the song that Pinsir sings in the second act.
Yes.
Is the seventh version of that title that I wrote. And the funny thing is that as I kept writing new versions, I kept simplifying it till I finally got down to this one, which is a very simple song. By that time, I had gotten so discouraged with the whole thing that I wanted to throw it out. And at this point, I just played it for Logan to show them, to prove to him that I'd been working for a long time on it. And he heard it, and he said, "That's it. Don't change it. Don't touch it." And I said, "But it's so simple. He said, "Leave well enough alone. That's the way it's going to be."
And do you ever change a song, Harold, after you hear the performer do it?
Yes, sometimes you do. You find out on the stage that things you thought projected don't come through, that you've made it too complicated, or sometimes that you've made it too simple. Usually it's the other way. Usually it's a process of simplifying what you've done, because it has to be pretty clear and broad on the stage.
Well, Harold, it's certainly wonderful to hear some of the problems and trials and tribulations behind the scenes of a great successful musical like Fanny. I think we'll rest now a moment. Our talk, if we might, I'll go back to the podium and I'll turn this microphone back to Ken.
Thank you, Skitch. And now that we've heard about how Harold Rome wrote the title song, let's hear the result. Earl Wrightson sings Fanny.
As I may live, Fanny, 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 you long as I may live, Fanny, if I could love, that's what I would say. Mine to give, Fanny, Fanny, Fanny. No, no, not mine to give, Fanny, for it is gone, given long away. The sea, my one love, in her gray green clothes, deep with wonders beyond the shore, through the isles, neath the winds, where the spice wood grows, I must know them all, or sleep no more. With no heart to give, Fanny, Fanny, Fanny. Not worth one tear you'll cry, Fanny, oh, Fanny.
I'll have to, at this time, ask Mr. Banghart, the gentleman of the orchestra, and Mr. Harold Rome, whom we're saluting tonight, also Josh Logan and all the company. I'll have to ask them to stand aside, if I may, because as a conductor, it's a great pleasure for me to talk to singers at any time. But this singer is extra special because she's not only very wonderful in the voice medium as to vocal ability, but a fine actress. And besides that, her last name just happens to be Henderson.
Thank you, Mr. Henderson.
Oh, Florence, please don't say that.
Sounds so funny to say it to someone.
You know, let's straighten out everything right now. You told me before we went on the air that people had asked you about it. Are we related?
Well, when I was back in Owensboro, Kentucky, I used to claim you quite frequently, yes, I must admit.
But actually, legally, we're not related at all.
No, I'm afraid not.
I think we should draw up some legal papers, maybe, that we could
That might be a good idea, mm-hmm. you know.
I can see it now. Let's see, Florence and Skitch, I suppose. That would
well,
be the
billing. Well, I'd give you top billing. I think you deserve it.
Florence, your first, I think the first thing that we knew and saw of you in show business here in New York was the Rodgers Hammerstein extravaganza on television. Is that right?
Yes, that was a great thrill for me to be. Well, I guess I was the only unknown amongst all those great talents, and they mm-hmm. were just wonderful.
How did this come about?
Well, I had read about the R&H, you know, that they were going to do the salute to R&H, mm-hmm. and I was playing in Oklahoma at the time in...
Where?
In Boston.
I see.
So I got a wire from my manager saying that I was going to do the show, and I just couldn't believe it because I'd been reading Mary Martin and mm-hmm. Ezio Pinza and all of these wonderful people, and I thought, what in the world would they want me there for? Mm-hmm. So, but... Mr. Rogers and Mr. Hammerstein wanted me to do People Will Say We're in Love. Mm-hmm. So I had to commute from Boston to New York every day to rehearse and go back and do the show at night. And so it was a little tiring, but it was well worth it. The first day I walked into rehearsal, Mary Martin was rehearsing Wonderful Guy, mm-hmm. which, of course, I just got a lump in my throat and the tears came, and I went to Johnny Fernley, who works for Rogers and Hammerstein. I said, I can't go up there. I just can't sing. And he said, yes, you will. And of course, I was called next to rehearse. And well, it just proved to be a wonderful, wonderful experience. Mm-hmm. And they all set a wonderful example for me. Because as you know how great all of them are, and they were all as wonderfully sincere and helpful and kind as they could be to me.
It's strange, you know, we often say that the biggest stars in the theater are the nicest people, and I think you've just proven it, because people like Mary Martin, whom I've had the good fortune of knowing and working with for many years, I can't think of any person in the world that I would give three gold stars to.
You know, last night I got the most beautiful telegram from Mary Martin.
Really?
I was just thrilled.
How, by chance, did Fanny come about? Was it because you did the R&H Spectacular?
No, it may have had something to do with it. I'm mm-hmm. sure it did, but my first Broadway appearance was in Wish You Were Here, and I was in the chorus with one line.
Right. I knew that, too, yes.
I auditioned for the understudy and everything to the lead, you know, mm-hmm. when I was in the show, for all the understudies, for that matter. I knew all of them, male and female. So Mr. Logan had, you know, he had heard me sing, and he had seen a little of my work. And so when I was in Philadelphia, again in Oklahoma, I was called by Mr. David Hawker mm-hmm. of MCA, whom I didn't know, but he said, told me of this show, Fanny, and he said, I think you should do the title role. I can't see anyone else. And I said, please, you know, I'm very grateful to you. But he said, Mr. Logan wants to hear you. And I, of course, my manager is Mr. Poland, and mm-hmm. I explained this to him. And he very wonderfully called my manager and set up the thing, but he bowed out completely. And I came in for an audition again, commuted from Philadelphia. And I auditioned over an hour for Mr. Logan and Mr. Merrick and Mr. Rome. And they said, well, it's wonderful, and you've grown so much, but still we have to go further. And I said, of course, I understand. Mm-hmm. I was grateful to have the audition, you know, so... Nothing happened for a few months, and I thought, well, it's kind of hopeless for me, you know. And then when I was in Philadelphia again, we played there twice during the tour, and I was called again by Mr. Logan. And he said, well, Florence, we want to hear you again, but, you know, we must, it's a very big thing. And I said, yes, sir, I understand. So they called me in again. We closed in Boston in May. And I went to New York, and about a week later, they had me come and audition. And they still, at least they made me feel, they still weren't quite sure. And
the psychology of the producer.
Yes, and I asked if I might go home. It had been almost 3 years. And so if they needed me, that they could call, and I would come back immediately. And I was home about 3 days, and my manager called and said, Florence, it's yours. And so here I am.
You have just heard... told in person a fairy story which has come true, and it's just wonderful. I can say from my own personal standpoint, Florence, I had the great pleasure, of course, of seeing the show under rather unusual circumstances, but I can just tell you that I'm your fan.
Oh, and I'm yours. We can be the Mutual Admiration Society.
So the little team of Florence and Skitch go down through
the
years in music.
Well, I'd just like to say, when you were saw our show under rather unusual circumstances. Most of the cast was quite thrilled to have you in the audience and gave us a little bit of the jitters, you know. But it was wonderful.
Well, I want to thank you very, very much, Florence. I know your problems as to schedule and everything. I wish you the very best of luck in Fanny. All I want to say is the people that are across the country listening to the voice of Florence Henderson, when you're in New York, see Fanny and hear it in person and see it, because it's just wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Skitch.
Righto.
Hi, this is Porchlight Music Theater producing artistic associate Frankie Leo Bennett. If you value programming like this, please consider making a donation today at porchlightmusictheater.org. We appreciate your consideration and hope you enjoy the show.
You are listening to Best of All, tonight featuring music from Fanny, starring Skitch Henderson, with Earl Wrightson, Clark Dennis, Elizabeth Doubleday, Sylvia Michaels, and Keith Texter, and interviews with Ezio Pinza, Florence Henderson, William Tabbert, and Harold Rome. Part two will follow after a brief pause for station identification.
Stay tuned for more of Skitch Henderson and Best of All over most NBC radio stations.
This is Kenneth Banghart presenting part two of Best of All. Tonight starring Skitch Henderson with Earl Wrightson, Clark Dennis, Elizabeth Doubleday, Sylvia Michaels, Keith Texter, and interviews with Ezio Pinza, Florence Henderson, William Tabbert, and Harold Rome. And to open the second half of our show, Sylvia Michaels and Keith Texter sing the happy rhythmic hit from Fanny, Be Kind to Your Parents.
Be kind to your parents, though they don't deserve it. Remember, they're grown-ups, a difficult stage of life. They're apt to be nervous and overexcited, confused from their daily storm and strife. Just keep in mind, though it sounds odd, I know, most parents once were children long ago.
Incredible!
So treat them with patience and sweet understanding, in spite of the foolish things they do. Someday you may wake up and find you're a parent too. Here's a piece of good advice. Think it over once or twice. Be kind to your parents, though they don't deserve it. Remember, they're grown-ups, a difficult stage of life. They're apt to be nervous and overexcited, confused from their daily storm and strife. Just keep in mind, though it sounds odd, I know, most parents once were children long ago.
Incredible!
So treat them with patience and sweet understanding, in spite of the foolish things they do. Someday you may wake up and find you're a parent too. And find you're a parent too.
And And now here's Skitch to introduce us to another star performer of the great new Broadway musical, Fanny. Skitch?
Thank you, Ken. You know, the story of Fanny is not only the story of Fanny herself, played so capably by Florence Henderson, but the story of the love of Fanny and three great male stars. I don't know where you could look on her theater marquee, any place in the world, and have more joy and more talent than this. The stars, of course, I shan't give billing, but just mention the men, Ezio Pinza, Walter Slezak, and the man that's across the microphone with me here tonight, an old and good friend. I always think of South Pacific, Bill Tabbert. Bill?
Well, thank you, Skitch. I don't know about that old business. I feel old.
Young friend.
I had a long run in Pacific, and maybe that makes me a little old. And as far as the earlier part about the three great stars, I don't know. Two great ones, but one I hope someday to be in their category, because they're real top-notch boys.
You're being unnecessarily humble, Bill, because seeing the performance, I feel exactly the way I said. Bill, is there a relation between the role that you have in Fanny and the role that you had in South Pacific, emotionally, to yourself?
In a way, there is. In Pacific, of course, I was madly in love with the Tonkinese girl, but family background prohibited me getting to the point that I wanted to marry her, and then, of course, I went off and was killed, which is probably a simple way of getting out of it, I suppose. Yeah. And in this one, of course, I'm torn by the sea from the side of my loved one, and when I finally realize that it's she that I love, in the meantime, she has gone off and married that darn old Walter Slezak, and so, of course, that fixes me up. Mm-hmm. And I better not tell any more of the story. It might tip it. I don't know, unless somebody's already told it.
Yes.
But
no.
I'll leave it go just at that. What happens later is up to anybody's opinion until they see the show. However, it is kind of a parallel thing. In both cases, by hook or by crook, I lose the girl after having made such a wonderful start.
And besides that, you get to sing the title song, which means, I think, means
yes,
so much psychologically.
It does. It's frankly, I'm just thrilled with the score. Not only my music, but everybody's bit of music in it. It's almost like an opera. That the music just, it's so much in context in it, and it just flows along that. It really gives me a real thrill to be in this show and to sing this music. Of course, I've told Harold Rome, the composer, many times what I thought of his score, and maybe he thinks I'm putting it on, but I do think very highly of it.
It's a magnificent score, I think. Is it difficult to attain a consistency in a singing performance of the level that you would like?
No. Once you hit a routine, I found that in Pacific, that the beginning was a little hard because you're not settled down and the voice probably isn't in that groove. Mm-hmm. But I find that after a few weeks of a steady routine, that your voice becomes so accustomed to the special routine and the special requirements each performance that they're no longer special. They become very routine as far as the physical being is concerned. Of course, then you have to hypo yourself all the time with the emotional thing. And if you don't have it, or if you cannot bring this about, then you have no business to stay in the show. You should quit and get out. And that's
very
the one thing
man.
That I felt in Pacific. When people came after me to get out after 2 years, it's better for you professionally and all that kind of business. I kept talking to myself, not always aloud, thank goodness, about whether or not I still felt this thing. And I found that even when the show closed, after we had done just a little short of 5 years, that I still got a great thrill out of doing the part. And each time I stepped on the stage, I had that almost opening night feeling, which is the same thing I've had with Fanny, the out-of-town things, and, of course, the performances we've done here in New York already. Each performance is a brand-new thing. I actually weep legitimate tears when the sad parts come along because I really get so wrapped up in it that I feel sorry for myself or somebody else for the position they're in, and it's just, I tell you, it's just good, that's all.
I can think of no greater advertisement for any people that might be thinking of coming to New York and going to the theater than this paragraph just delivered by one Mr. Bill Tabbert, who's one of the stars of Fanny. Bill, I know that you have a horrendous schedule. In fact, I know right now we transcribed this because obviously you're in the theater performing. I want to thank you for taking the time and trouble to come by, and I hope when the next musical comes along, we can do a repeat on this.
Well, I hope that this one runs as long, Sketch, as Pacific. Then you can call me an old friend. Thanks very much, Sketch.
Thank you, Bill.
Harold Rome has written another appealing love song for Fanny, which Sylvia Michaels sings for us now. I Have to Tell You.
I have to tell you, I have to, though I don't know where to start, I have to say.
Continuing our salute to the musical Fanny, here is Sketch Henderson with the great star of the show. Sketch?
I'm sitting right now in one of the dressing rooms of the Majestic Theater. There's a man right on my left that is very, very tired. A good friend of mine and a good friend of the American public via his great starring roles, beginning, I suppose, with the Opera House through South Pacific. Mr. Pienza, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Sketch. How are you?
Oh, it's a pleasure to see you, Ezio.
Pleasure's mine.
I know that you're more than a little tired. I think we should tell the public what you've been doing this afternoon.
Well, we have worked 4 hours in taking pictures for Life magazine, and they haven't finished yet.
They haven't finished
no,
yet?
No, no. They want to make an hour tomorrow night after the show. I said that tomorrow night after the show, we go to bed because Wednesday we have 2 performances, but nothing to do. Well, you know, this is the life of the theater.
Nothing ever changes through the years.
Never.
Ezio, do you miss the Opera House?
Well, I must tell you the truth. I don't know now if I've been getting used to this kind of life I do now. I don't very much. I don't. Mm-hmm. And besides, I tell you, many people ask me, are you going back? Yeah. And I don't believe in coming back. I'm always afraid, you know, and I'm not afraid, but I'm sure they would stay there with the gun and say, well, it's not anymore what it was. Right. I prefer to leave it like it was, you see.
Are you still a fan of the opera?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes, I like opera very much. I think the opera is still one of the greatest entertainment we have.
You know, talking about the Opera House, I think something rather unusual is happening tonight at the Metropolitan here in New York. They're doing, scenes from different operas. What do you think of that idea for an opening night?
Well, I don't agree with it, but as long as it brings money to the opera, to help run the opera, because, you know, opera is a very expensive proposition, and unless it's subsidized by somebody, it's very difficult.
But do you honestly think that helps the opera? You say if it brings money, and do you think it does bring money? Maybe it does,
well,
this night, but
I don't know. I mean, the management must have found out that this is the way to do it. I don't know. I would prefer to make less money and to do it more artistically. That's all.
Have you ever heard of this being done before?
No, I have. Yes, I have heard this being done before, but in a special occasion, like they call it opera party, you know, opera benefit, something like that. Mm-hmm. I have never assisted in an opening which is done with different acts of different operas. But this is the new trend, you know. Mm-hmm. I don't want to criticize anybody, mm-hmm. but I think that the opera has the tendency of wanting to go, let's say, Broadway.
See?
And I was born a kind of a purist, you know.
Yes.
I like things done in the right way, in the way they should be done, and I don't agree, suppose, in modernizing opera that have been written 100 years ago or 200 years ago. I think they should stay as they were.
What do you think of the English lyrics to the Puccini operas?
Well, I don't think the lyrics that were put at the Bohemian at the Metropolitan were very good. Mm-hmm. I don't think they were good. And believe me, I understand that the American public like to understand what they are singing on the stage.
Surely.
This is natural. But translation is always difficult because music was written for that kind of language, and to translate it in another language is always, you miss something.
Yes.
I tell you the truth, when I sang in Italy, they always sing everything in Italian, and I sang Meister Singers in Italian. The
really?
At with Toscanini alla Scala in 1922. But sometimes I didn't know what I was singing. I mean, take an example, for instance, Falstaff.
Yes.
See, in Falstaff is a phrase that in Italian it says from 2 to 3,
yes.
See?
Uh-huh.
But in the English language you cannot say dalle due alle tre, they have to say from 11 to 2, you see, instead of 2 to 3, from 11. I mean, it doesn't make a great difference as long as the lower sees his lady. But this is just an example that sometimes you have to ruin the all meaning. I mean, you cannot make the translation literally, you have to make it musically, see, and at the same time, the words have to change.
As long as we're talking about comparisons in music, that being in the operatic field, how about a comparison, or would you care to make a comparison at all between South Pacific and Fanny?
Well, the two stories are completely different, and the character I am playing is completely different. I like, by the way, I like very much this character of Cesar.
I love the warmth of Cesar.
Yeah, because I tell you, the first time I saw the picture called Fanny,
yes,
and I saw this great Remy acting the part of Cesar, I said to Logan, I said, you know what? That's my father. I saw my father, and the name of my father was Cesare in Italian, so it would be Cesare in French.
Yes.
He had the same name. And when I walked on the stage on the, what they call it, the ice cream suit, you know, when I go to see my lady love, well, I see my father walking. I really. And I really enjoy very much this character. Oh, I enjoyed very much Emile de Bell too, you know,
course,
don't get me wrong. But this is complete, you see, and it's more, it fits more to me because, well, South Pacific was a romantic part that was well fitted for a man of my age,
mm-hmm.
See, but you cannot always find a good romantic part for a man that has a certain age, you know, I mean, after all.
this is the youngest sailor of the yacht club.
Yeah.
Ezio, seeing you in this part makes me think that maybe, eventually in the theater, you're going to go to a straight acting role. Could that be true?
Yes. After this is the last musical I will take.
Really?
I want to do a straight role. Maybe I break my neck.
Oh,
maybe.
It should be wonderful.
But I know they say that people will say, why doesn't he sing? Well, I'm singing off, my good. I mean, I'm singing for 40 years now. Mm-hmm. I mean, and I don't want to be nervous that maybe my voice is not so well tonight and I have to sing. When mm-hmm. you have to speak, well, you speak all the time. Even mm-hmm. if the voice is a little tired, you speak. But singing is another thing. And besides, when I sing, being that I come from the opera, the people expect me to sing well,
yes,
you see,
there
and
are
that
no
makes
excuses.
Me nervous, you see.
Yeah, I've noticed that psychologically that people are, they are inclined to be more critical of somebody like yourself that has such a wonderful
background. Well, they want to hear, they think this comes from the opera, must have a good voice.
Well, I'm going to let you probably go over to Sardi's and get something to eat. I want to tell you, it's been a pleasure for me to talk to you here. I hate to take your time knowing your schedule. I wish you the very best of luck in Fanny.
Thank
as you
very,
know.
Very much. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
The Harold Rome score and the Harold Rome lyrics for Fanny are particularly appealing because the composer, a man of sensitivity, finds his own emotions aroused by the simplest of life's experiences, and he's able to communicate his feeling to us in both words and music. There is, for example, in Fanny, a great song for Ezio Pinza to sing to his son Marius, played by William Tabert, a song which speaks of all the familiar things which, taken together, spell to all of us the simple concept, home. Earl Wrightson, with Skitch Henderson in the orchestra, sings Welcome Home.
Why, even when I leave this neighborhood for only a day, to go to the beach or the vineyards across the bay, no matter what I do or see, after turning home again, I get to that corner and then... Sweet voices, I hear sweet voices calling to me. Welcome home, says the street, as I hurry on my way. Welcome home, sings the gate like a song. Welcome home, says the door, glad to feel your hand once more. Now you're back where you belong. Welcome home, says the chair, holding out its friendly arms. Welcome home, says the bed, rest on me. Now you're back where you should be. Close your eyes, close your eyes, and the world will settle down to sighs. Welcome home, says the lamp, lighting up familiar things. Look around at your friends, good and true. Get your cares all untied while you're warming up inside. Welcome home to you. Welcome home to you. Familiar things, look around at your friends, good and true. Get your cares all untied while you're warming up inside. Welcome home to you, my son. Welcome home to you.
Now back to Skitch Henderson and the composer of all these wonderful songs from Fanny, Harold Rome.
You know, Harold, this might seem a silly question after all the talk about music and music in the theater, but how did you begin in music?
It's not a silly question at all, Skitch. It's A very good question. I began by my mother making me take piano lessons when I was 8 years old. That's how I started. There were five kids in our family. Every one of them took piano lessons. None of the rest of them went to music as a profession. But I think all of us gained by being forced to take lessons and being forced to know something about music.
Harold, it would be unfair to have you in this studio tonight without asking you to do at least a few of the wonderful bars of melody from Fanny. I especially would like to hear you, if you had the time, do To My Wife. And also, I wonder why this was written. Did this have any personal dedication?
Sketch, you know just as well as I do that everything you write has a personal thing. You don't, you write out of, if you don't write out of your own insides, then it's no good anyway. I happen to be a very happily married man. I've been married for 15 years, and this was a chance to tell my wife that, too. It happens to fit in the show.
Yes.
But I call this the kissing song because the first time I played it, I always play songs for my wife first because she's very good about criticizing them and giving me the first audience reaction. The first time I played this song for her, her eyes filled with tears, and she just leaned over and kissed me. Then at when we had our first reading, Walter Slezak had no idea this song was in the show because it was one of the last written. And I played it during the reading, and when I got through, he came up and kissed me. Then he went home and sang it for his wife, and she kissed him.
So do you think we could have a performance here?
Sure. I hope my wife is listening in. My wife, who walks so gently through my thoughts all day long, clean and fresh and white, soft and strong, makes me feel like there is nothing I can't do if I try, with my wife and son standing by. She may scold, say I eat too much, find some fault, give free advice. But a meal needs that added touch of salt and spice to be extra nice. Words won't do. There's so much I must thank her for. Where to start? How am I to say from the heart what I owe to my critic, my partner, the flavor of my life, to my wife?
I want to take this opportunity on behalf of our company here on Best of All to thank you for allowing us the privilege of paying this tribute to Fanny tonight.
Well, thank you, Skitch, for allowing us to be here. And when I say us, I really mean us. You know, a musical is a cooperative effort, one of the biggest there is. And everybody involved is part of it. It's nobody does it by themselves. It's right down from the producers, David Merrick and Josh Logan, through all the stars like Walter Slezak, Ezio Pinza, Florence Henderson, Bill Tarbert, and all the others, and everybody in the company. It's a matter of all working together, and this has been a wonderful experience for me. And I thank you for all of them, not for myself.
Thank you, Harold.
have been listening to Best of All, tonight featuring music from the new musical Fanny. And tonight you heard Skitch Henderson, Earl Wrightson, Elizabeth Doubleday, Clark Dennis, Sylvia Michaels, Keith Texter, and interviews with the stars of Fanny, Ezio Pinza, Florence Henderson, William Tabard, and composer Harold Rome. This is Kenneth Banghart inviting you to be with us next week for another special musical feature on Best of All with Skitch Henderson and the orchestra. Continuity for Best of All was written by Robert Senadella. This is an NBC Radio Network production directed by George Moutsas. Portions of this program were transcribed.
The stars of Fanny were some of music theater's top performers of the day. Ezio Pinza spent 22 seasons at New York's Metropolitan Opera, appearing in more than 750 performances of 50 operas. Pinza also sang to great acclaim at La Scala, Milan, and at the Royal Opera House, Covent Garden, London. After retiring from the Met in 1948, he enjoyed a fresh career on Broadway in musical theater, most notably in South Pacific, in which he created the role of Emile Debeck. William Tabard appeared in the musicals What's Up, Follow the Girls, Seven Lively Arts, Billion Dollar Baby, and Three to Make Ready. After his success in the long-running South Pacific as Lieutenant Cable, Tabert returned to singing in nightclubs and appeared regularly on radio and television shows such as The Ed Sullivan Show, The Voice of Firestone, and Armstrong Circle Theater. Florence Henderson debuted on Broadway in the musical Wish You Were Here in 1952. In 1953, she played Laurie in Oklahoma at City Center and starred opposite Jose Farrar as the girl who came to supper, a 1963 Noel Coward musical adaptation of The Sleeping Prince, which had been adapted as the Marilyn Monroe Laurence Olivier film The Prince and the Showgirl. Of course, she will always be remembered as Carol Brady on TV's The Brady Bunch. Theaters across the country need your support now, more than ever. We hope you'll consider a donation to Porchlight Music Theater today. Just go to porchlightmusictheater.org. Until next time on classic musicals from the golden age of radio, I'm Michael Weber.